Hi. Well, we are in a serious time, and Jim and I are both of us troubled in our spirit, so I wanted to just share a few things about prayer with you tonight, but I don't know. I'm looking at the time, and I really want us to pray tonight. It's important that we pray tonight. So what I'll do is let me just talk to you just a little bit about prayer. I mean, Jim was preaching this morning at Eddie and Donna's Rock, and he said, I can make a sailboat, but I doesn't mean I know how to sail. I mean, we can teach about prayer until the cows come home or forever, but if we don't pray, it's not going to do any good. But I believe in prayer. You saw tonight my husband give an altar call, and 15 people and plus came forward. And I remember 27 years ago when he didn't give altar calls, and he said, I don't give altar calls. And God spoke to my spirit and said, I want you to tell him to give altar calls, and he wouldn't. And so then God showed me how to pray and told me specifically what to pray for as I took the word of God with me in prayer. And he showed me Isaiah chapter 12, verse 3, with joy shall you drink from the wells of salvation. And he showed me how to pray for this land. He said, you've got land, but you don't have water. Ask me for the wells. Ask me for the wells. And I began to pray and intercede. This was before the rock was, there was 18 people in it. That was it. It was at the very beginning. So I know the power of prayer. I know that God can instruct us in prayer. I know that God can talk to you. God spoke to me when I was pregnant with Luke and said, I want you to pray for two things. And I prayed for two things the whole time I carried him. And I didn't stop praying for that. I prayed for my kids. I saw God deliver them out of hell right into heaven. I've prayed for things that have come into this church and finances and jobs and marriages. And I believe in prayer. And I believe, like Jim said, that we are in a very serious time of crossroads right now. When I was in Israel last July, God spoke to me at the Museum of Holocaust. I had such a God encounter in that museum. It shook me to my core. And I gathered the people that were on tour with me from the Rock, and I spoke to them. And I came back, and I told you that God spoke to me and said, we are at a crossroad, and the decisions that we make now are going to affect future generations. And so I believe that. And I believe that God wants us not just to learn about prayer, but to actually step into the responsibility of doing what only we can do, which is the body of Christ, which is to pray. And so tonight I wanted to, in the next few moments, just look at something, because Michelle asked me a question a week ago. She asked me, what is prayer got to do with incense and fragrance, and where is that in the Bible? And I didn't know what to say to her. I knew the answer way back when, but it troubled me. So I went to the Word, and I want to talk tonight before we get into prayer, the fragrant power of prayer. And I want you to look with me for just a moment, and let's look to the Word, because everything in the Old Testament was a symbol and a type of the New Testament. Jesus said, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I'll raise it back up. I'll build it again. And they crucified him, and they mocked him, and they said, you said it took us 46 years to build this temple, and in 3 days you're going to raise it up. But they didn't realize he was speaking of his body. And it says now that we are the body of Christ. We are the temple of the Holy Spirit, that in that resurrection and in the power of that blood sacrifice, God took a people for himself that were introduced to us in the Old Testament through the tabernacle and the temple and the things that were in that tabernacle. But those things in that tabernacle were a type and a shadow of you and I today. And so the things in that tabernacle are important to prayer. And what has it got to do with prayer? And I just wanted to read it to you. And I don't know what I do with my glasses, but 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14 says, Now thanks be to God who always leads us in triumph in Christ and through us diffuses the fragrance of his knowledge in every place. For we are to God the fragrance of Christ among those who are being saved and among those who are perishing. To the one we are the aroma of death leading to death, and to the other the aroma of life leading to life. Who's sufficient for these things? Who's sufficient? We're the fragrance. We're a smell. We actually have a scent and an odor to God. And in the spirit realm that you and I cannot see. And in the old covenant, in the Old Testament, when God gave Moses the law, he said to build a tabernacle in the wilderness. And this tabernacle was going to have an inner court and an outer court. And it was going to have the Holy of Holies. And then it was going to have the holy place inside this big tent. And that's where God met with Israel. That was the place where God and Israel met together. That was, if you'll allow me to say this, that was God's moment of Eden with Israel. God was back on the earth with man for a moment in that tabernacle. He met with Israel. And the Holy of Holies is where the Ark of the Covenant was. And that's where the high priest would take the blood once a year and spread it on that Ark of the Covenant and the mercy seat. And Israel would be atoned for 1 year. But before that Ark, there was a place called the Holy Place. And in that Holy Place, there was the showbread table. And there was a golden candlestick that had a light to it, 7 lights. And then there was this altar of incense. And on the altar of incense, God gave them a recipe that was never to be copied, but was to be burned twice and continually every day in the morning and at night. First, the high priest, Aaron and his sons came in and they lit the candlestick, and then they went and they took coals from the bronze altar, which was outside the tabernacle where the sacrifice was given day and night, twice a day. In the morning and in the night, there was slaughter and sacrifice on that bronze altar. And the coals from that altar, God said, take those coals and bring them into the altar inside the holy place, the tabernacle. And I want you to take this incense recipe and I want you to burn it. Now, what has that got to do with prayer? Good question. But look, just take a look at this high priest. And here's the altar right here. That's the altar of incense right there. And right behind it is the veil that separated God from his people. It was the Holy of Holies, and God met there on the Ark of the Covenant, on the mercy seat. That's where the blood was shed once a year. But that incense was burnt every day of the week, every day in that tabernacle. Are you with me? So John looks up, and he says something in Revelation chapter 5. And he says, this is what does incense have to do with prayer? He said in Revelation 5:8, he said, now when he had taken the scroll, so he's up in heaven, he's at the throne of God, he's seen into the invisible realm, he's seen multidimensional beings, the seraph, the burning ones, and the cherubim, and he's seeing the crystal sea and the elders, and it's an incredible thing, and he's weeping because no one's worthy to take the title deed of earth, the scroll. And here comes a lion of the tribe of Judah. He takes the scroll out of God's almighty hand, he opens it up, and he begins to unseal things. And as he does, it says in the chapter 5, it says, now when he had taken the scroll and the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb. So now they're worshiping before God's throne in heaven, each having a harp and golden bowls full of incense. There's the incense again. Remember, the tabernacle was a type and shadow of the heavenly temple. Are you with me? It's where Jesus shed his blood. So it says here that there were bowls of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. David said in Psalm 142, let my prayer be set before you as incense, the lifting of my hands as the evening sacrifice. So incense in the Old Testament was, if you will allow me to say this, was the place and was the doorbell of opening the front door to God. They burned incense before the Holy of Holies. God wanted a sweet smelling savor and smell from incense. We're made in his image. Do you like to smell things? Are there things that cause you to remember or cause you to be in a certain mood when you smell something? Well, you're made in the image of God. And God said, I want to smell this. You're not to make it for anybody else. And it's to burn day and night in the tabernacle before my Holy of Holies. And then he tells us what it is, what the spiritual interpretation of that is now, as we are the temple of the Holy Spirit, that it is the prayers of the saints. So if you want to get into the presence of God, and if I want to get into the presence of God, prayer is the doorbell. It is the door knocker that opens up the door into God's very throne and God's very presence. Now you're looking at me like cows looking at a wheat field, but listen, a grass field. Listen, we got to grow up sometime and understand that these are not just little things. Everything means something in the Word of God. And just because we can't see the invisible world, it made everything we can see. And there are thrones and there are powers and there are principalities and there are rulers of darkness in high places. And God has given us power and authority to pull these things down and to begin to pray and not allow these things to happen. And when we begin to pray, it opens the door into the presence of God and into what God needs us to do. Now, let's move on because we're going to pray. So incense in the Old Testament, and if I could just show that one picture. I showed you the high priest, but could you just show him the tabernacle? There it is. There's the temple, and there's the altar of incense, and there's the veil, and you can see a side place of it. So that's what you and I are now. We are the temple of the Holy Spirit. So prayer opens the door, and prayer that is in faith in the blood of Jesus and in the name of Jesus absolutely. Can you believe this? My glasses are stuck in my lace. Only I could do that as I'm teaching you about power and authority. But you see, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter how silly and foolish I may seem as a weak little old lady, because I know who my Jesus is. And prayer, as it is not just the door and the doorbell and the smell that God needs and wants, but prayer in the name of Jesus and the blood of Jesus opens the door to power and authority when a church prays in faith. Can I have that scripture up there? 2 Corinthians chapter 1. For all the promises of God in him are yes, and in him, amen, to the glory of God. When I come to God in prayer, and I realize that I stand on the earth as his representation, as that high priest went into the holy place, lit the incense, as that high priest and only the high priest and his sons, there was no one else that could do it. As I realize that I'm a royal priesthood, I'm a chosen generation, and there is no one else on the earth that has the privilege or the mandate to step into the holy place, to begin to present myself before the throne of God and begin to believe in faith in the blood of Jesus that gives me every promise of God because it was paid for by the blood, and begin to invoke the will of God upon the earth. There's no one else that can do that. And when the church comes together in faith in the blood and the name of Jesus, anything is possible. And what we ask on earth, we can have in heaven. Can I have John chapter 16? And in that day you will ask me nothing. Most assuredly, I say to you, whatever you ask the Father in my name, he will give you. Can I have Romans chapter 8? What shall we say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? Keep going. And he who did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Keep going. Who shall bring a charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Keep going. Who is he who condemns? It is Christ who died and furthermore is also risen, who is even at the right hand of the Father, who also makes intercession for us. When the church on the earth begins to stand in that place of holy prayer and she begins to invoke the promises of God in the blood of Jesus, by the authority in that blood speaks and says, yes, it's yours. I've taken it. I have the keys of death and hell. There is nothing that my promise has purchased in that blood that you cannot have. And in my name, ask the Father and he will give it to you. When we begin to ask in faith, not minds wandering, in faith, weapons out, shields up, in faith. Did you ever see the Hunger Games? You ever seen The Hobbit or all of those warrior movies that we all love? Do you ever wonder why we love them so much? Because on the inside of us, there are warriors that want to come out because there's an invisible war that we've got to get into and start kicking some butt and start pulling down some strongholds and start getting serious about this. There are spirits of infirmity that are coming upon the people of God and they are not being healed. There are principalities right now over this nation that want to see this nation fall down and not get back up. But I don't believe that's the will of God. So prayer opens the door. It's the fragrance. It's the incense. Prayer and faith in the blood of Jesus and the name of Jesus. My gosh, what is it he won't give us? And the last thing that prayer does tonight before we pray is prayer in agreement now brings in unity, brings forth the authority of Jesus Christ on the earth. Matthew 18:18-20. And this is my last verse. And then Jim's going to come and Dr. Kobernick and we're going to pray. Assuredly, I say to you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Whatever you forbid, whatever you will not allow on the earth will not and cannot be allowed in heaven. Whatever you release on this planet must be what is already released in heaven. Let me ask you, is healing in heaven? Did the blood of Jesus say, by his stripes you are healed? Is there peace in heaven in the blood of Jesus and the promises of God? He is the Prince of Peace. Does God want our nation at peace and not in prejudice and fighting? Every promise of God is yes and amen. It's allowed in heaven, but he needs his body to pray it in to the earth realm. He will not do this without us. So when we pray in agreement, whatever I say to you, if you agree on earth concerning anything, it will be done for them by my Father. Keep going, last verse. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, there I am in the midst of them. My nation that has given birth to me, I could have been born anywhere on the planet, but God let me be born in the United States of America, 1950. I'm old enough to see change, great changes. I love this country. It's where God planted me. I could have been born everywhere else, anywhere else. God brought me to America. God had me be an American. I don't want to see my country fail. I don't want to see the next generation not come into all that God has. I want to see a world evangelized so the king can come back and the Masonic kingdom can come. And Satan has a plan to crush this nation. Dr. Kobernick, will you come and will you stand with me? And if we stay in agreement in the blood and in the name, nothing that we ask, God said, we can't have. We can have it if we ask, if it's his will.
Just everybody get a picture that we're going to pray for the next 10, 12 minutes and then let you go at 7:30. And we'll probably pray a little bit longer than that. But those of you that need to go, it's okay. You can go. You can go anytime. Nobody's holding you back. We love you. Thank you for coming to church. But we're going to pray for the next 10, 12 minutes and maybe even a little longer. And so if you need to go again, then go. But don't disturb the children. If you have children in children's church, they're learning their lessons and doing children's church right now. So they'll be ready to go at 7:30. But let's pray.
Almighty God, we come into your holy place boldly because you have told us to come. And Almighty God, it's not okay for our nation that was born under you for the glory of God and the advancement of your kingdom to accept the murder of innocent babies and protect the murderers. It's not okay for in this nation,
yes, Jesus,
for sexual perversion to be accepted and promoted and protected legally. And I'm not just talking about homosexuality, God, but also about premarital sex, about adultery, and about divorce. It's not okay that in this nation we have Christian businessmen and women who have to pay very large fines that may drive them out of business because they've been doing business in a way that honors you. It's not okay, Lord, that in this nation, voters vote based on what's good for them personally, financially, and what will make them feel good about themselves continuing in their sinful lifestyles instead of voting for what's going to make a difference for their children and grandchildren so that you get glory and your people have your blessings. And so, Lord God, we're here protesting what the devil is getting away with in America. And we ask for a change, Almighty God.
Yes.
We ask for a change, Almighty God.
Yes.
We ask for a change, Almighty God. We ask, Lord, that you would bring revival to your church first,
yes,
and foremost. We ask that you would bring conviction to Christians who have been voting for the wrong reasons, for the wrong people, and the wrong causes. We ask that you would bring a people movement to Jesus among the general population so that voters will vote for what is godly and right and good for the future and brings glory to you and blessings to their children and grandchildren. And so, God, we not only want godly leaders, and we're praying for that, but God, we need something before the election. We need a revival in the next 8 months that will change the voters so we can vote in what you want.
Yes.
Almighty God, we ask that you'd have mercy on America. Remember the prayer movements of the 80s and 90s, God, and you did some amazing things in the world and in this country in answer to prayer, but we have not been saved yet. God, and the worst thing of all, Lord, is we do not want, it's not okay for Satan to populate hell with Americans on our watch. And yes. It's not okay for Satan to take over and turn America to the dark side on our watch. God, we are the church, and we're coming into your throne room boldly, and we say it's not okay. We plead the blood of Jesus. We don't want leaders that we deserve. We want leaders by the mercy of God that will be godly and God-fearing and bring our nation and our laws and our people and our way of living back to yours. It's not okay for our high schools and middle schools and elementary schools to teach our children that good is bad and bad is good. We ask, Lord, that you would have mercy on America and change us. And Lord, we are not pardon me, God, we are not timid. God, we are a loud church, and we don't want to let our frustrations and anger, which are godly in righteous indignation, yes, to be directed against people around us, including our leaders. We plead the blood of Jesus for mercy on our leaders. We've been instructed by you, God, and we do hold up before you our president and our members of Congress,
yes,
and our justices, and we ask,
yes,
Lord, that you would move upon them. We ask, God, that you would bring them dreams if you need to change their mind, nightmares for those who need it, Lord. We have too many national leaders who are deluded, believing lies, practicing evil, and God, we need a change. We ask that you would have mercy on them and save them, that you'd awaken them and cause them to be responsible, because they're going to have to answer to you for what they're doing.
Yes.
But God, we also ask that you would change America, beginning with revival in the churches, including the Inland Empire, including the Rock.
Yes.
God, change us. Make us the people you want us to be. Make every single member of this church have the fear of God when it comes to going into a voting booth. Father, we ask that you would stir up your church to cry out to you for what you want to happen,
yes,
in America, and to hold on until you do it.
Thank you,
and we're
Jesus.
Coming right now, and we say that the principalities and powers and kings of darkness over the United States of America,
yes,
we speak to you, and we say in the name of Jesus and by his blood, you will not win. We say in the name of Jesus and by his blood, you're coming down. We say in the name of Jesus and by his blood, you will not control our nation. We cry out in Jesus' name. Imbalance them, cause them to fall over, Almighty God, and bring in your authority, your governance, your righteousness to America. In Jesus' name, and all the people shouted.
Amen. I just want to add to that prayer. Father, we just thank you that the next candidate, that the candidates that we have running for president of the United States are going to be godly, whether it be a male or female, they're going to be godly. They're going to respond to you. If you have to visit them in the middle of the night and put the fear of God inside of them. Lord, I am so sick of people running for offices that'll say anything and do anything, Lord, just to get elected, just a bunch of hype and a bunch of baloney. I've seen it all my life, Lord, and it's time now for us to have a godly president in the White House. We want a godly president, one who cares about you, one who has a heart for the truth, which is your word, God, and will give you the praise and will give you the glory, that will bring in a Supreme Court judge that is godly, Father, for a change in this nation. And we thank you for it, Father. In Jesus' mighty name.
And expose the lies and the deceit, Father. Remove the web and the veil that is over the hearts and over our eyes so that we can see clearly your will and how and what you want us to do as your people. Now, there are people in this place that have illnesses and that have been sick, or you know family members, and you know people that have had attacks on their bodies in this church. And Pastor Dan, Pastor Luke, and Pastor Jess, I'd like the three of you to come up, and we're going to finish praying. These are the three things that God told me to pray for tonight. Was for the Rock, Pastor Luke, for the Shift generation, for this generation. Pastor Jess, there was a pastor that was shot, and for healing. So if you wouldn't mind, the three of you praying for that, I'm going to release this to you.
Yeah, do you know that the pastor was with Ted Cruz, praying for Ted Cruz last night, was shot in his pulpit this morning? And don't tell me that's not demonic, my friends. You know, that's demonic. And so, and he happens to be a pastor who is a relative of someone in our church. That's how we know about it. I don't know if you gave the picture to them.
I didn't give the picture.
Did we?
I can text it to them so they can.
That's
see.
All right. It's too late now. But let's pray and believe God. He's still alive. He was shot 6 times.
His name is Tim. He's fighting for his life. He's
Remington.
Tim Remington. And he's the senior pastor of a church called The Altar in
Coeur d'Alene, Idaho.
So, dear Father God, we just come before you, God. And we stand in the gap for Pastor Tim. And God, we pray, God, that you would just send doctors and the nurses, Lord, bring wisdom to them, guide their hands, Holy Spirit. Lord, we pray for a miraculous miracle, God, a tangible miracle in his body, Lord. We ask that he will live and not die. Lord, we ask that he will live to preach your name and to make your name famous. Lord, that it would be a living testimony of your healing, of your blessing to our country. And Lord, we pray, God, for strength for his family in this time, Holy Spirit. We pray that you'd wrap your arms around them and be the comforter that you are. And Lord, we thank you, God, that no weapon formed against this man will prosper. It will not take his life. And devil, you have no assignment or plan on the pastors that here at this church or around the world, Lord. We ask for protection, God, upon us as we begin to do what it is you've asked us to do. And Lord, we pray, God, over America. And God, I pray every pastor in America. There has been several that have been shot this year. There have been several that have had assignments placed on them, but we break every assignment that the enemy has laid out. Yes. We stand in the gap right now. We call it dead. We pray in the name of Jesus that they will live and not die. And that devil, your assignments will not withstand the power of Jesus' name. Yes. And Lord, we thank you, God, that no weapon formed against any pastor will prosper. And we thank you for safety and protection in our churches, in our children's ministries, in our youth departments, in the offices, wherever it is that we're going in the highways and the byways preaching the gospel, Lord, that you go before us and you keep us safe in Jesus' mighty name. And everybody said,
if you're sick in your body, go ahead and lift your hand to the Lord right now, or if you want to stand in the gap on behalf of someone else. And I'm just going to pray a prayer of healing and pray for the Rock tonight. Father, we just come to you in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, I thank you for those that are here tonight that are battling illness, God. Lord, there is no name of any illness that is above the name of Jesus. And so we declare that mighty name, that in that name there is healing, in that name there is power, in that name there is salvation of the whole man, body, soul, and spirit. And so I thank you, Father God, that right now that physical bodies are healed, God, in the name of Jesus. Yes. We curse every sickness and we command it to leave in the mighty name of Jesus. Yes. I curse cancers. I curse diabetes. Yes. I curse every heart problem in the name of Jesus. I curse every circulation problem right now in the name of Jesus. I curse dimming of the eyes. I curse deafness in the ears. I curse every problem that would come against the vital organs of these bodies, Father. In the name of Jesus, I lift up to you those who have been battling sicknesses for a long time. I break the power of these illnesses and of these hurts in the name of Jesus. And I command healing to those who are here and to those who are afar off, God. Those that are in the hospital right now from this house, Lord. We pray for our people, God, and we ask for your healing virtue to go out from the throne room of heaven right now in the name of Jesus, and that, God, you would touch, God, you would strengthen, God, you would reform, God, you would recreate, God, that you would make new, God, that you would strengthen, God, that it would never be the same, God, that we will have never felt better, never been better, never had more ability, Father God. Thank you, Lord, that legs are stretching out, that arms are now getting mobility in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Father God, that there's breath in the lungs, God, and that all the oxygen and everything flows the right way. Digestive tracts are healed in Jesus' name, God. We thank you, Lord, even Mike Key's wrist is getting healed right now in the name of Jesus. And Father, we praise you, Lord. We pray for our church, God. Lord, we lift up to you every department, every ministry, God, every member, every guest, God. Lord, we pray that as we go into this Easter season, God, that you open doors of opportunity for us to preach the gospel and to proclaim the good news. God, we ask that you fill this house multiple times over. Every church service, every venue, God, whether it be children's youth, La Roca, God, the sunrise service, God, may the courtyard be filled. Lord, we ask, God, that the altars be filled, that every altar call that's given, God, that the full number of people that need to respond, Lord, would come and lay down their lives before you, Lord, because you laid down your life for them. And Father God, that they would receive of that resurrection power, God, and that that old man would be gone and that they would become new, never to be the same again. And Lord, may they not fall away. May none backslide, may none walk away, God. But we pray, Father God, that they are retained and that they come to church, that they are planted in the house of God. Lord, we thank you for growth. We thank you, God, this is a praying church. We thank you that this is a prevailing church in Jesus' mighty name.
Lord, we lift up the next generation. We call the millennial generation. Just like Jesus, when he looked up and he saw that the field was ripe for harvest, he said to his laborers, he said to his disciples that the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Lord, we see statistics are showing that the millennial generation is poised to be the largest generation in America. And so, Father, we look across that and we see what might be appearing to be a wasteland of youth, Father, of lack of morality, of lack of intelligence. But God, we look across that and we choose to see, Lord, not what is visible, but God, we choose to see what is invisible. Lord, we see a great generation that is rising up, that is being poised, that is being positioned by the Spirit of God to have their eyes opened and awakened to the glory and the goodness of God. Lord, as your word says, that the God of this age has darkened and blinded the minds of the people, that the light of the glory of Jesus would not shine. Paul the Apostle says, we don't preach the gospel of ourselves. We preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. And is it not God who commanded light to shine in the darkness? And so, Father, to this generation, we command in the name of Jesus, the light of Jesus Christ to shine in the darkness of the generations to come. Lord, your word says that one generation shall declare your works to the next. So, Father, we choose, we commit, we speak now of the millennial and the young generations, God, that are coming up, Lord, that they would know you. We claim them for your kingdom. We claim them for your glory. Father, as they come seeking truth, as they come seeking spirituality, Lord, I pray that they would find it in Jesus. Lord, that you would reveal yourself to them with signs, wonders, and miracles, and gifts of the Holy Spirit. Lord, we pray for a Book of Acts revival in the millennial generation. Lord, they're hungry. They need you. And Lord, we ask, Lord, that you would send laborers across their path, laborers into the universities, laborers into the workplaces, laborers into the highways and the byways, into the schools and into the cities to reach the young for you. And God, we'll teach them, we'll train them, we'll show them your ways. And God, we'll believe that the statistics that say 7 out of 10 walk away from God, we'll claim that and say in the name of Jesus, that is not true. And we say that they will come, your word says, to train them up in the way that they will go, and they'll not depart from it. So, Lord, we lift up the millennial generation. We lift up the future generations of America, and we say that this is a nation that will serve you. This is a nation that was formed under God, and in God we trust, and God, we put you in our trust. We put you in our sights. Lord, help us to reach the next generation for your kingdom and for your glory in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. I asked Dr. Paul if he'll come and pray for our Spanish-speaking communities all over the nation that are, you may not know this, but they're under horrible pressure right now. And we need, there are brothers and our sisters. We need to pray for them. We need to pray that they stand strong in this time. There's a real insecurity out there. And I'm going to ask you to pray in Spanish. You know how to speak that language. It's your heavenly language anyway. You know, when all of us get to heaven anyway, God's going to say, ¿Cómo está? And we better answer correctly, huh? And so I want you to pray for our Spanish-speaking Americans. Even, I don't give a flip. If they're in America, we need to love them and take care of them and fight for them. Now, I don't disagree that we ought to build a wall, but the ones that are here we need to love them and respect them. We need to pray for them. Are you in agreement with that?
Absolutely.
Then
absolutely.
Go ahead, my friend.
So you want me to pray in Spanish?
Whatever language you're comfortable in. Tongues if you want. I don't care.
No, I'll do both. That way everybody's kind of in the loop here. But Father God, I just ask that you would bring your wisdom, your understanding from above, Lord. Just like Pastor Jim expressed, we stand on your word. And your word clearly says, do not harm this foreigner. Do not harm this stranger, because once you were a foreigner in the land of Egypt,
yes,
Father God. And so we ask today that that same thought, that same idea that you carry out through the word of God, it never changed. And I ask today, Lord God, that we maintain that. And when Israel was in trouble, they ran to Egypt. They got the help. They came back out. When Jesus needed to be hidden, he was in Egypt and came back out to do ministry. Father God, I pray that in Jesus' name, that for whatever reason they're here, and this is not Egypt, but it is the land they're here now, Father, I ask that they become effective, that they advance, that they do what you've called them to do. But more than anything, I come against the spirit of fear that binds them,
yes,
from advancing in every area in their life, Father God. And I pray that you would open their eyes, that they find the gospel, the true gospel here, Lord God. This nation is full of the gospel,
yes.
TV, radio, printed media. There's no more gospel than in this nation. I pray that their lives are changed and transform here, Lord God, that if maybe they go back to their country, they bring the gospel with them for advancement in every area of their life, Father God. So I pray for that right now. I pray for wisdom on our political leaders, Lord God, to make the right decisions, to make the right direction. This political topic is so charged, but there's people in the middle of all this energy, Lord God, and I ask for your wisdom to cover this people who are in the middle of this situation right now,
yes,
in every area of their life, Father. We ask for wisdom right now, and I'll pray in Spanish. Padre, en el nombre de Jesús, te pido por sabiduría en medio de esta situación, Señor, que tú hagas una obra de transformación, Señor, que tú cuides a tu gente que está en medio de esta situación, no importa que sean legales o ilegales, Señor, que tú hagas una obra en medio de ellos, que el evangelio llegue hasta las puertas de sus hogares para transformación de una nación. Yo te lo pido, Señor, por nuestro presidente, por nuestros líderes, Señor, que tomen la dirección correcta en cada área de sus vidas para este pueblo que está en medio de esta situación. Hoy te lo pedimos en el nombre poderoso de Jesús, lo decimos. Amén y amén.
Thank you. Now tonight, it's time to let you all go. But there's a few of you here, I'm going to ask you to come as the music sings and musicians sing these last few minutes, that you feel in your heart you just want to repent for America. You know, sometimes people have to stand in the gap. I'm not saying you've done anything wrong, but we're part of a country that has done some bad things. I love this country. I mean, you cut me open, I'm red, white, and blue, and I'll fight for it to the death. But, you know, I also am wise enough to know there's a God that had ordained this country to be what it is. In fact, when we were talking to a guy that led, if you will, Brother Zhang from China, has 10 million underground church people. Someone in our conversation was saying how bad America was. They're just not serious about the things like he is. And he stopped them right in the middle of their sentence through an interpreter and said, "Don't talk bad about America. If it wasn't for America, we wouldn't be saved in China today." And I'm telling you, this is a great country. Was a great country. But I need some people to come and cry out. Not only God forgive us, we'll just do this, but God mercy. We want mercy for this country. We need mercy right now for a president that is a godly president. God, we refuse it. We want mercy, God. And here's what I'm asking. Let's do that. Anybody that feels like they need to get down on their knees and cry for mercy and ask for forgiveness for the sins of this nation. My gosh, there's so many. And yet, at the same time, you're standing in the gap. You're the intercessor. And if you want to stay in your seat and pray, fine. Or if you want to go home, go. It's okay. Don't feel guilty about it. We love you. But let's, as they worship, as they sing this song, let's cry for mercy and ask God for forgiveness for our nation.
Let there be fragrance to your throne,
Lord,
God.
We thank.
We lift up our city of San Bernardino. Lord, let there be revival. That's the only thing that's going to change this city, God. These are your people, and we bless them tonight, Father, in the name of Jesus. Bless these saints that'll pray with us during the week and pray for this country and this city and this nation and this state. We give you the praise and the glory and the honor. Everybody say amen. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, stand to your feet and give the Lord a great big praise. Thank you, Lord.